Hey guys, today we're going to be discussing how to build a railgun. Now, if you don't know what that is, I'm going to put a little demonstration of the Navy's over here on the right, and that might get you interested. If you're not interested by this, well, just stop watching the video. It's not for you. Now, before we start discussing how to build the railgun, I want to discuss how it works so that you can understand it fully and make one as custom as you would like. After that, we're going to go into a list of materials and the tools that you're going to need, and then we'll get into building.
Now, the principles that a railgun operates by are actually fairly simple. You're just going to have two parallel rails, which are going to have to be made out of a conductive metal. Today, we'll be using aluminum. You'll attach the positive current to one end and the negative current to the other rail. And you'll have an armature in the middle. This armature also needs to be conductive. It's going to be acting as a switch for your circuit. And as the current travels down one rail, it will transfer onto the armature and onto the other rail. It will create a magnetic field in the volume that is contained here, and then the projectile will be propelled forward. First off is the list of materials. Keep in mind that you don't actually have to use any of the materials I'll be listing, you just have to use something that will complete that material's specific task. The materials that you'll need are a conductive railing, I'll be using aluminum, something non-conductive to hold the base of all this, we'll just be using wood. You'll need screws, washers, nuts, bolts, etc. You'll need solder, a conductive projectile. I'll be using a ball bearing that I picked up from Ace. Capacitors. Now, these guys work the best, these 300-volt capacitors, but they take a while to ship, and I didn't have the time, so I'm just going to be using this piece of crap from Radio Shack. You'll need a way to charge them. The best way would be to just convert AC current into DC and then charge them with that, but we don't have an AC to DC converter, so we'll just be using 9-volt batteries and alligator clips. The tools that I used were a saw, a soldering iron, a drill, clamps. I didn't have a voltmeter, but a voltmeter would have been extremely useful, a center punch, and a hammer. The first step, as you might have guessed, is making the actual rails. I cut this aluminum bar down into two 12-inch pieces, which I will then bolt onto the platform of wood with this block of wood here in the middle as a spacer. Sawed our 2x4 in half, leaving a decent amount of room past the rails for a step later to come. What we're going to do here is center punch a little dent into the 2, 6, and 10 mark to start bolting in these rails. Now all you have to do is drill out the locations that you marked and countersink those holes. Once you're done drilling in all of your screws, it should look something like this. The second step is creating an initial velocity for your projectile. If you leave the projectile on the rails and then start applying a current to it, it's just going to think that it's part of the rails, and it will start actually welding onto the rails as the current passes through it. So a few examples of how to give it an initial velocity would be a spring mechanism that's going to shoot it into the rails, or a gas pressure pushing it into the rails like a CO2 canister or something. Today we're just going to keep it real simple though and use our good old friend gravity. To do this, we're going to take our 2x4 and saw it at a 45-degree angle, which we will then attach to the base of our railgun. Once again, we're going to use the same wooden block as a spacer to keep our spacing consistent, and then we'll drill these guys in. And here's a little test run of us dropping a projectile down. The third and final step of building the railgun is powering it. Now this is by far the hardest step, and it ultimately has the most influence over the performance of the railgun than any other step. The best method is to create a capacitor bank, which is a series of capacitors. Now, the capacitors that we actually bought are going to be no good. They have a max of 50 volts, which we can obtain just by connecting 5 of our 9-volt batteries together. So we're going to skip that and just use the 9-volt batteries to power it. But if you plan ahead and you can buy some online, I would recommend buying 3 of those capacitors that I showed earlier, connecting them with 2 bus bars, which if you need more information, you can look up how to do this online. I did some research online to see if I could connect all of my 9-volt batteries into a series, and it turns out that if I connect them a certain way, it'll actually double the voltage that they put out. So when I connect all five of them, I should be expecting 90 volts. I wanted to put it to the test to make sure that I was getting more volts, but I didn't have a voltmeter, so I tried something else.
All right, so what we have here is some LEDs to test off the brightness to show how much volt it's going to give off since we don't have a voltmeter with us. So as you can see, kind of dim. Now when we use three of them, significantly brighter.
Now you're going to want to solder two individual wires, one to each of the rails at its base. Then take the end of the wire and attach it to an alligator clip. Now that you've done all that, you just have to take your alligator clips, attach one of them to the positive end of your energy source and the other to the negative end of the energy source. We did a lot of test trials, but I'm running out of time, so here's the last one. Now that obviously wasn't what we wanted out of the railgun, so let's take some time and identify where we went wrong. There were two major problems with the design. The first was unavoidable. It was the batteries that we used. We really needed these 300 volt capacitors, but they're not sold at any local nearby stores. They can only be found online as far as the area that I was in, and they take forever to ship. So we had to stick with those 9 volt batteries, which were just not putting out enough power. The second problem was too low of an initial velocity. The other test runs that I didn't have time to show, ones where we didn't even use power, the ball bearing actually slid faster than when we applied power to it. And as we applied more and more 9 volt batteries, it just got slower, which leads me to believe that the ball bearing was trying to weld itself to the rails. Now, if we used a spring mechanism or a gas mechanism to give it a decent amount of starting velocity, it might have worked as intended. Thanks for watching, everybody. Anyone who decides to try and do this for themselves, I wish you luck, and I hope it turns out better than my gun did. I'll be addressing the particular issues with mine and then posting updates on my own personal channel if you're interested in annotation here. Remember to have fun out there, but most importantly, be safe. Thanks, guys.